long years ago, and out in sea, I had no home, no peace within, and on my knees in agony, I prayed to Jesus and he gladly set me free. And I never shall forget the day when all the burdens from my soul rolled away. It made me happy, glad and free. I sang and shouted, for he's everything to me. Now I can feel him by my side. My feeble steps, he comes to guide. When trials come, he comforts me. Through my faith in him, I have victory. And I never shy. Forget the day when all the burdens from my soul rolled away. It made me happy, glad and free. And I sang and shouted, for he's everything to me. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now. At his dear feet, just humbly bow. Confess to him your every sin. He'll save and cleanse you, give you peace and joy within. And I never shall forget the day when all the burdens from my soul rolled away. It made me happy, glad and free. And I sing and shouted, for he's everything to me. One more time. And I never shall forget the day when all the burdens from my soul rolled. Good morning, church. How you doing? Good to see you. Some of you look a little better this morning. That's just a joke. I'm just kidding.
No, anybody seriously, here? You do look better this morning.
Look better than I did the last 2 weeks? Not absent. All right. Anybody do a little worship this morning? Anybody here still love Jesus, no matter if you got a mask on or not? That's good. There is good news for the captive, good news for the shame. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. Well, he's our rescuer, and he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Know how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He's beauty for the blind man, riches for the poor. He is friendship for the one the world ignores. For the weary, rest for those who strive. Know the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Yeah, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Well, he's our rescuer, he's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. So come and be chainless. be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction. Here at the foot of Calvary. Well, he's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. One more time. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer.
Woo! See your rescuer this morning. Do not be gripped in fear, my friends.
Like a lamb led to the slaughter, Jesus never opened his mouth. From the trial to the crucifixion, to the grave he was laid out. After 3 days in the garden tomb, I could hear the angels sing. As the lamb came forth as the lion, and the lion became the king. You won't find him again at the whipping post, standing there so meek. And he won't be nailed to the rugged cross, through his hands and through his feet. And there'll never be another Calvary, cause it don't have to prove one thing. There the lamb became the lion, and the lion became the king. His splendor to live on earth with man. By most he was rejected, cause he came forth as a lamb. Oh, but the day is soon approaching that every eye shall see. The lamb and the lion of Judah has been crowned the King of Kings. You won't find him again at the whipping post, standing there so meek. And he won't be nailed to the rugged cross, through his hands and through his feet. There'll never be another Calvary, cause they don't have to prove one thing. There the lamb became the lion, and the lion became the king. Put your hands together this one. You won't find him again at the whipping post, standing there so meek. And he won't be nailed to the rugged cross, through his hands and through his feet. And there'll never be another Calvary, cause they don't have to prove one thing. There the lamb became the lion, and the lion became the king. Yeah, the lamb became the lion, and the lion became the king.
Woo. You ready, Miss Debbie?
Ready as I'll ever be.
This is a good one right here.
He was born in a stable, in a borrowed manger. He borrowed a lunch to feed a lot of strangers. He borrowed a colt to ride into town on. He borrowed a tomb, but he wouldn't need. And the only thing he bought
You believe it, you receive it. morning. Anybody believe that God is in the house this morning? He is. If there's any doubt, Cowboy Church has now had our first runner. We got little Dodson back here. If y'all missed it, girl or boy? Boy. What's his name? Huh? Gadget? Gadget. Okay, this dog's name is Gadget. Anyways, he's our first runner. Ran all the way down there, around there, and all the way across the front and back up to his dad. Yay, Cowboy Church got our first runner. But seriously, I did want to share a story about actually my dog, and there she is, Daisy. Besides, we needed something good to look at today besides mask, right? So, yeah. But I want to talk about, Daisy has this thing, she doesn't like the heat. Anybody else relate to Daisy? Okay, it's hot. It was really hot yesterday, and I think it's going to be even hotter today. But she does this, my husband Roger, God love him, he thinks she needs to go outside. She doesn't think she needs to go outside. So yesterday I noticed that he'd tell her, okay, Daisy, you need to go outside. We're going outside to do some work. You need to go out and get some fresh air. That's what he's telling her. So he takes her out the basement door, and what she does, she runs around to the front door, this glass front door, sits here and looks at me like my mom's going to let me in. And she just sits there patiently. She doesn't jump on the door. She doesn't, bark or anything. She just sits there looking in there, and I'll just notice her and go by and let her in so she doesn't have to be out in the heat. But the thing is that she had faith in me. She never even doubted. I have no idea what happened to the mic. She never doubted for one moment that her owner was going to let her in. So she had faith, great faith in me, just sitting there waiting. But there's a centurion in the Gospel of Matthew that had greater faith. He had great faith in Jesus. And this centurion had a young servant. It was a young boy. And the boy was in great pain and he was paralyzed. And the centurion cared about this boy. He had compassion on him. Well, the Jewish leaders of the day went to Jesus and pled on behalf of the centurion and on behalf of this boy. And they were saying things like, you know what? This guy, this centurion, is a great guy. He's a good guy. He's helped build the synagogue. He's very generous, so Jesus, could you help him out somehow? But the centurion himself knew that there was something different about Jesus. He wasn't just a Jewish rabbi or Jewish teacher. He was the Son of God. And the centurion, he could have been demanding and arrogant because he was a captain in one of the greatest empires this world has known. But yet the text says that he comes to Jesus and says, I'm unworthy. I'm not worthy for you to even come to my house. Because he knew that Jesus, if he would just say the word, that this young boy would be healed. So Jesus turns to the centurion and he says, I have not seen this kind of faith among Israel, not among the religious leaders, not among the people of God. Truly, I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with so great a faith. So then Jesus turns to the centurion and says, go, as you have believed, let it be done for you. And so his servant is healed at that very moment. Did you see the faith of this centurion? He's like, Jesus, you don't even have to come to my house. It's miles away. You can just say the word. I know you can just say the word and he will be healed. He didn't doubt. He had faith, just like Daisy standing at the door. She knew I was going to open the door. What kind of faith are we walking in? What kind of faith do we have? And what would Jesus say of our faith? Do we believe that God is good and that he wants good for us? Do we believe that God can do what he says he can do? I mean, really, do we believe these things? My assignment for you guys today is to go home this afternoon and ask yourselves these questions. Do some soul searching. What would Jesus say of our faith this morning? I think if we want to see God do some amazing things, and I think we all do, that we need to have faith like the centurion. Let's pray. Father, this morning, I thank you, Lord, that you're a God that can just say the word and it's done. Lord, I'm so thankful. Lord, that you're at work in our lives, Lord. I'm so thankful that you're good and that you want good for us. And Lord, I believe these things. And Lord, I just pray that you would show yourself at the remaining of this worship service. Show yourself strong, Lord. We want to see you. We want to see you in all your glory. In your name I pray. Amen.
splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself. At his voice, how great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all we'll see, how great is our God. Thank you. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious fear than grace the pain. The hour I first believed, my chains are.
So glad to have you with us today, those that are present, those that are joining us online, and whether you're in your barnyard, whether you're in your truck or car, or your home, or still in bed listening to us, it's good to come together to worship, and amen. I really didn't know how many would show up today, and so I just prayed something like this: Lord, you know those who need it. Sure enough, you guys showed up. I mean, just like I prayed. No, seriously, it is so good to have you with us. Also good to have with us once again the Volunteer Christian Builders. Guys, stand up, and gals, and stand up if you would. Woo! These are the mighty servants of our God. The scripture says those that are least will be the most. And if you want to be the most, be the least. One of the things they love to do is give their time and their lives and their skills to the Lord and go from church to church or campground, wherever a need is in the Christian world, take their building skills and minister to us and to other churches that we might take what they've done and then reach out and minister to others as well. They're going to be working on our children's edition back there. So glad to have you. God bless you. You're already a blessing to us. Now here's the deal. Whenever I preach, I'm only half as good as I am in the Lord, and the other half's up to you. You know the routine? Okay. All right. Now, if you want good preaching, you got to do your part. I've been praying, okay? It's 50-50 deal. If you came in here not ready to receive, if you came in here not prayed up, Lord, bless me, Lord, feed me, Lord, use me. I mean, even Gidget got excited about being here. But nonetheless, I'm telling you, it's time to pray and to say, God, let's do something. Amen? Don't just walk in and think, well, the preacher's got, I tell you what the preacher can do. Jesus said, I can do nothing without him. And so I can do nothing, but I'm trusting him to do everything. And when without the Holy Spirit taking the Word of God and making it alive to you, it will just be another, you know, 30 or 40, 20 minutes. Okay, another 20 minutes of preaching that you've listened to. So let's go to the throne, okay? Let's go to the throne and say, God, if we're going to be here, we want to get something from you. I didn't even hear you guys alive over here. God, if we're going to be here, we want to get something from you. Amen. Mask on or mask off, it makes no difference, Lord. We need something for you. And if you have not, because you ask not. And so I want us to ask before we begin the preaching time of this service, okay? Let me pray. Father, I come this morning, and Lord, I come on behalf of all of us. Lord, we are a needy people. Oh, Lord, every day we're needy, Lord. But particular this day, Lord, it is an odd occasion for us to be wearing masks, Lord. We know it is. It's not the norm for us together with masks on, but we're here. Father, we don't want to just merely come to say we came. We don't merely want to come because it's a habit, even though it's a good habit, Lord. We want to come and say we came because we wanted to gather with the body of Christ. We wanted to touch. We wanted to see. We wanted to hear. We wanted to experience the lives of one another as we've gathered together. And Father, we also want to gather online, Lord, literally around this world, Lord, we're reaching people. And Lord, we want to come and give you this time and say, take it, O Holy Spirit. Please take it and use it, O Holy Spirit. Minister to us that we might be better ministers of yours. Now that I pray, and I pray it in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, most of you are aware over the last 2 weeks and now the third week, I started a series, and it's basically this. Whenever things are uncertain, whenever you're confused about what to do and how to do it, one of the wisest things we can do as a believer are to go back to the basics of our faith, to the basic disciplines of our faith. And so what I'm going to do and have been doing, I'm going to do the first 3 weeks, today will be the third, on the discipline of prayer. If you're really not for certain what to do, you know that God always calls us to pray. He says to pray always. We're always called to be that. And so 3 weeks ago, I challenged you to come before the God, the Holy Spirit, and say, Lord, teach me to pray. Do you remember that? Amen? Do you remember that? Have you continued to pray that prayer, and let it be an ever-breathed prayer of us unto our God is, Lord, keep teaching me to pray, Lord. Where I am this morning and where I am this day, Lord, I want to go farther in my relationship with you. I want to go farther in my prayer ministry in you. So, Lord, teach me to pray. I believe if we will learn to pray and then do what God has taught us, we can turn this world upside down, and we can turn our lives right side up, and we can do all of those things if we will just take advantage of the discipline of prayer. And so today I want to pick up, if I can, and kind of bring this to the last message in this series on prayer. Now, no doubt we'll be talking about prayer throughout the year, always do, but nonetheless, let me continue on, if I can, with another lesson on prayer. Are you ready? Yep. Amen. Here we go. Amen. Woo, that's what I'm talking about. Had to come from Illinois. That's good stuff. We love you guys. Listen what Jesus said, and man, Jesus was a prayer warrior. Jesus not only taught about praying, but he got about praying. And we too need to be like our Jesus. But listen what he says in Mark chapter 11 in verse 24. It's one of my favorite verses. And Jesus said this, therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Woo! Can I read that one more time? What he said, therefore I say unto you, Jesus speaking, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Four simple things we want to draw out of this passage. The things that we can pray about. Number two is the desires of our prayers. Number three is the faith of our prayers. And number four is the expectancy of our prayers. Let's look, if we could, first up about the things of prayer. It says, what things soever you desire. Can I ask you a question? what are you praying for? What are the things that you're praying for? I mean, if I had to ask you to make a list of them, what would that list be? Well, Jim, I'm praying for this, and I'm praying for this, and I'm praying for this. And it'd be interesting to know what you're praying for. Jesus says that he, whatever things we have that connect to our life, that are a part of our life, that we can come and pray to him. That's an invitation to him. No matter what things, no whether they be big things or small things, whether they be spiritual things or practical things, whether they be things that concern you or things that concern your family, whether it be relationship, whatever things that you have in your life, my friend, we can pray for them. And Lord needs to help us to learn, if we might, that we might learn to pray for all things in our life, in every aspect, from the least to the most, that we would be a people that pray, and let the prayers that we pray be heard by God, that can make a difference in whatever things that are touching our lives. We're foolish not to. If you could have the help of God Almighty help you in every aspect of your life, wouldn't you want that? It's a good time to say yes, brother. It's a good time to say yes. I mean, so whenever you get up and you say, Lord, this is my day, I'm going to work. And Lord, here are the things that I know that lie ahead of me in my work. Lord, I ask you to bless me, and I ask you to be make me a blessing as a result of that, and help me to do the things that it will be in my job today. And you just go through that list. You name them one by one and call out to him. Jesus says in scriptures, he says that you have not because you ask not. What we've got to learn to do are to be a people that learn to ask God. Now here's something that's really has always helped me in my prayer life, but as I'm getting older, even more so helps me in my prayer life. I need lists. I'm just telling you, I need lists. I have found that, whenever I've got two stores that I really like to go into. One is Bass Pro. I always love Bass Pro, and the other is National Rope and Supply. And so, but both of those are neat stores, but I would go to the National Rope and Supply in Decatur, Texas, do that every year during the American Rodeo. I'm just talking my life story. I know you want to hear it, but here we go. They call me Jibber Jabber Jim. I don't know why they call me that. But anyway, I found myself, I went there, and I walked out with nothing. I didn't buy one thing the first year that I can remember buying there. So after that, every time I go, I make a list of things that I can buy there that I can't buy right here at home. And I go in there with my list, and I'm on a mission now. I'm going my mission. I'm going to get it. I'm going to buy it. Bass Pro the same way, Chuck. You can go in there, think you're going to buy it. You get so distracted by everything, you come out of there by nothing. And Kim's excited about that. But you hear what I'm saying is, God, we can do that, and we can come before God with such a general prayer that we leave the throne of heaven with nothing that we know that we got there. I encourage you to get a paper and pencil, the number 2 lead pencil, or get on your smartphone or get on your computer. Start making a list that you bring to the shopping place called heaven with all the things that you need, God's help and God's provision in your life, and let him help you. Amen? Learn to do this. It will revolutionize our prayer lives whenever we do it, especially as we get older, guys. I mean, we can't remember what we did yesterday. Prayer's too important. What we need in our life, our God wants to supply. But the avenue for us to receive it is that wonderful avenue called prayer. Make you a shopping list, for lack of a term. Make you a shopping list whenever you go to heaven. Not only do we have the things of our prayers, number 2, it's the desire of our prayer. It's the heart of our prayer. Not only what are the things that you need, but number 2 is, what does your heart hunger for? What does your heart long for? What does your heart need? Bible says this in James chapter 5. It says, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The effective, the fervent prayer, the hot prayer, the flaming prayer, the full of passion prayer. Whenever we go to heaven and come to the throne of God, we need not leave there until we are set aflame, until we have a passion within us. Here's what happens with me sometimes, probably never you. Sometimes it kind of goes like this. I get there, really wasn't wanting to be there, but I knew I was supposed to be there, so I showed up there. And I knew if I stayed there a few more minutes, I could chalk it off my spiritual list or my churchy list, if you would. And whenever I leave there, ask me 10 minutes later what I prayed about, I couldn't even tell you. I couldn't. Because my heart wasn't in it. Because my passion wasn't in it. So what I've learned to do is sometimes whenever you go to prayer, you are passionate. You've got somebody sick in your life. You've got your finances that are in trouble in your life. You've got some relationship. Sometimes your heart is passionate whenever you go before God, immediately go whenever you go. You cannot wait to get there because you're in a heap of a trouble and in a heap of fixes, and you need the help of God to do that. And so there's sometimes when that passion is there, and God says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So those are the times, if you look back, those are the times where you say, man, did I ever see the hand of God move? Woo! I looked out today, our song leader at Gravel Hill, Todd, last year we were praying for Landon, his oldest son. He had a terrible side-by-side accident, and it was amazing he was even alive. It was no problem to pray, my friend. It was no problem for Todd and Lisa to pray because that was their son, and he was near death, and they couldn't help but pray. Are you with me? But what about those other days? What about those other days? What about the most of the days whenever there's not some big emergency in our life? What we've got to learn to do is if we're going to take time to pray, then let's get something. Then we need to come before God in those days and say, God, man, you know my heart today. Lord, my heart's not in this, oh God. So Holy Spirit, would you help my heart to get in it? And God, I'm not going to leave you till I get into my prayer. You know what I mean by getting into my prayer, until my prayer has some passion. Jacob, whenever he was wrestling with God, he said, I will not let you go until you bless me. We need to have that same kind of passion. Lord, I will not let you go until I get into this prayer. Come on, guys. Wonder why your prayer life is dull. You wonder why your prayer life is, can't wait to get there. Wonder why you're not seeing much action in your life as a result of your prayers. There's no passion. There's no passion. And when you don't have passion, it said the fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Well, the cold prayers don't avail much. But that be true? The opposite would be true? And so, well, I just kind of a dull day today. Well, don't just be dull. Don't leave till you get undull. I don't even know if that's a word. Are you with me? Yeah. Amen. Don't leave. Don't leave. God, I'm not leaving, Lord. I'm not getting up from my knees. I'm not getting away from my prayer time till you and I, the God of heaven, and me, the child of you, my God, until I know I have met with you and you have met with me. It's those fervent prayers that God says that availeth much. A good friend that I hunted with for years, and Bob's a good guy. Before he met Jesus, he's tough. I mean, really tough. But anyway, his daughter, about 9 years old, came to faith. And Bob was walking down the hallway about late at night, and it's time for her to be in bed, and he could hear her weeping. And so he said, I paused because there's my daughter weeping. And all of a sudden, I realized why she was weeping. My daughter was praying. I saw there on the beside of her bed, she was kneeling and praying. And in tears, she was crying out, God, oh God, please save my dad. Lord, I don't want I don't want to go to heaven and my dad not be there. So, Lord, please, I'm begging you, save my dad. Now, you had to know Bob, this man of a man, strong man, tough man. He said, brought me to my knees. Her tears and her prayers moved my life from lost to found. And I gave my heart to Jesus that night. Amen. Amen. Yeah. It'll not only move a lost man, but it'll move God. Don't just do the Mickey Mouse habitual prayers. If we're going to be prayer warriors, then let's set ourselves apart and say, God, we're not leaving until we've met with you. Let your prayers be about anything. Let our prayers be passionate. Let our prayers be of faith. It says this as well. It says, therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things you desire when you pray, but catch this next word, believe that you receive them. Believe that you receive them. Let our prayers be prayers of faith. Now, faith is a growing thing in our life. We're not where we used to be in our faith, but Thank the Lord we're farther than we used to be. We're growing in our faith. And there's two ways that we find that our faith will grow. One are with the experiences of God. We've been on our knees before. We've prayed before. We've seen God hear. We've seen God answer. And so our faith has grown from those experiences of praying. But also, though, that faith has to be coming from the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. I can't stress this enough, but one of the greatest things you can learn to do is to pray with your Bible open, or read your Bible with a heart bent to prayer. I mean, let the Word of God start to flow in you. Let the Word of God start to convince you of who God is and what God can do. The more that we know about who He is and what we can do, our faith will grow, and we'll reach out and call out, and we will believe that He can do this. We need to have faith in our God. We need faith that our God is good. Amen. We got a good God, not just some of the time, but our God is good. We've got a God that's all power in heaven and earth has been given to Christ through the Father. I mean, He's not only a good God, He's an all-powerful God. He's an all-loving prayer. He's the God of grace, that's sitting upon the throne of grace, that we might find grace and mercy in our time of need. And so, therefore, I know that there's grace and mercy. I can come no matter if I've stumbled or fall or rebelled or whatever I might have done or not done in my life. I can come because He has promised me that I am welcome at that throne. It's the throne of grace. And so I can come, I can run, I can be accepted. I can, even Scripture says, I can even come boldly to the throne of grace when we pray. See, that faith, it's the Word of God, that you would never dreamt that you could boldly come to God. You could never dreamt that you could come to the all-holy God, and you unholy, and our righteousness is as filthy rags, that you could come totally known by God, but totally welcomed by this holy God. You can come in boldness. You can come in confidence. You can come in your filth. You can come in your sin before this holy God. And He says, so glad you came. Come, let us reason together, He says. You can come. So that faith grows by the hearing of the Word of God and by the experiences of living with God. So we need to be a people that grow in our faith of who God is and trust our God. But secondly, we need to be a people that trust prayer. Not just our God, but we need to trust the discipline and trust the invitation and trust the part of our living that's called prayer. My friend, prayer works. Amen? It works. If I could just walk from pew to pew, and not pew here, but seat to seat, just from seat to seat, and say, would you stand up? George, would you stand up? Stand up, brother. George, you were a highway patrolman, am I right?
Yes, sir.
Did God ever see you through some tough times?
Many, many times.
Did you ever pray in the midst of that duty?
Yes, sir, I did.
Did God hear?
Yes, sir, He did.
All right, you're walking without a cane, I see.
Yes, sir.
Did you pray about that?
Yes, sir, I did.
Did God answer?
Yes, sir, I did.
What if we just went from seat to seat? Thank you, George. I love you, brother. What if we just went from seat to seat and told our stories? Again and again, we would prove by experience that these words are true. And Satan does everything he can to convince us they're not. But this is the word that proves him the liar, and this is the truth. We've got to be a people that are a people of faith and incorporate that faith into our prayer life. One of the neatest things you can do is say, Lord, I'm just praying it right over there. I say, Lord, I'm not able to do this again today. Lord, I'm going to must have your help to do this. But Lord, you said that I can do all things through Christ because He strengthens me. So God, I'm trusting Christ to strengthen me. Strengthen me, Holy Spirit. Strengthen me, Savior. Jesus, you said you are my mediator, that you intercede on my ever live to intercede on my behalf. So Jesus, while I'm preaching, would you be praying? I ask Him to do that. I prayed according to what the Scripture told me that Jesus is doing and what Jesus wants to do. That's why it's so important that you do what we're going to start talking about next week. Get into the Word of God and get the Word of God into you. It will revolutionize your prayer life. We be a people that pray for all things. We be a people that pray from our heart. We be a people that pray in faith in God and faith in prayer. And in closing, we be a people that pray expectantly. And he says, therefore, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Wow. You shall have them. Neat. We need to get up from our prayers different than we nailed down. We do not need to get up from our prayers and say, well, Lord, here's my plan too. I don't know if you, in case you don't answer that. We need to get up and say, Lord, answer my prayers. I believe you're answering my prayers. I don't know when. I don't know where. I don't even know how, and I don't even care. But, Lord, answer my prayers according to your will. Answer my prayers. And leave that life expectantly. Leave it expectantly. I heard a story of some churches do where they make, I forgot what you call them, commitments about their giving. And so there was a young man who had just come to faith and had a mentor that was an older saint in the faith. And so the young man came to the older man and said, you know, I really think that God is calling me to give so much money on my tithes and through my offerings to the church. But I'm afraid that if I make that commitment that I can't carry it out. And the older man said to the younger man, said, well, I tell you what, if you can't meet your need, you just let me know and I'll meet what you can't meet. And that young man said, thank you so much. I feel so much better. And then the old man ended it with this. But it seems odd to me that you will trust me and not trust God. Amen? And not trust God. We need to cast our cares upon the Lord. Cast them out and let them fling. Don't go drawing them back. Don't go deep diving to get them out of the water. We need to cast our cares upon our Lord. For he careth for us. You see, whenever we come to that place of trusting him, our lives will change. It says in the book of Philippians, it says, in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Did you catch that little part, with thanksgiving? Let everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. With thanksgiving. Been praying for you guys and gals that have come as volunteer Christians. I said, Lord, I pray that you send those that need to be here to carry out your will. And Lord, I pray that you send those that we can pour back into them, Lord, that whenever they leave, that they will leave better than they came, that they will leave fuller than they came. Lord, I thank you that you're going to do it. I don't know how, I don't know whom's going to bring, but I know you're going to bring them. And all of a sudden, my prayer started changing whenever I left it there with him. Are you with me? When you leave it there with him. God, you know, I gave you that the other day, but I'm here again, once again, reminding you, but Lord, I'm leaving it with you. I'm just coming, Sam. I'm expecting you to do that. I believe you're going to do that. It's all right to say it again, but come with an expectant heart. Now, God, I'm just back again today. Is there anything I need to do in regard to that? Anything you need to show me in regard to that? Are you following me? Pray expectantly to the God that hears and to the God that's able. He'll make all the difference in the world. If we're going to change this world, my friend, I believe we've got to start on our knees. We're more than conquerors through Christ Jesus, but on our knees, we find access to that blessing and that position that we have in the Lord. Now, if you're like I am over the last months and the last days, there's a whole lot of things that I just don't understand about this COVID-19 situation. I mean, a lot of things. I don't know whether to social distance or not to social distance. I don't know whether to wear a mask or not to wear a mask. If I had my way, I know what I'd choose, but I'm just telling you, I don't really know. I read stuff on both sides. But I don't know if there's a vaccine actually coming or if it's not coming, oh Lord. I don't know if there's some medicine out there to fight it off or it's not out there, oh Lord. I just don't know. Am I the only one or has anybody got it all figured out? Man, I mean, this is one of those deals where I just don't know. I don't know what to do with the church that God's put together here. I mean, together or not together? I mean, those are questions. I'm being honest. I don't know. Don't know all that. God brought me to a place that said, Jim, this is what you do know. May I read what God tells me about such situations as this? Is any one of you in trouble? He should pray. This is God speaking. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Now catch this. Is any one of you sick? He should call the elders of the church to pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Woo! So that we may be healed. So that we may be healed. We have talked all the trash talk we want to talk. We have talked all the things that this might be right or that might be right. That might be Democratic. That might be Republican. We've talked all that junk. We talk it all the day. We spread all the news. We scatter a little farther. But when has anybody just said what we do know God called us to do? He said to call the elders, lay oil upon them and pray for the sick. And he didn't say maybe. He said they will be what? They will be what?
Healed.
Is there any sickness too bad for our God to heal?
No.
Neither is COVID-19.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said in Matthew as well as in Luke, part of the model prayer was, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I say it's high time we started praying for some deliverance. Amen. Amen. And if our faith isn't big enough to cover the whole world, our faith is big enough to cover our church. And if it's not big enough to cover our church, it's big enough to cover our family. If it's not big enough to cover our family, it's big enough to cover us. See what I'm saying? Let's do what he's taught us to do in relationship to situations like this. We've not exhausted what he said to do, and we're going to him saying, Lord, give us wisdom. He said, duh, I wrote it black print on white paper. I've preserved it year after year after year. And you've got it in your hands. You can put it in your mind. You can let it get into your heart. Pray. Pray. Pray when you don't know what to do. Do the basics. And prayer is one of the most basic things we can do. Now, before I close, I want us to pray. Can I pray on behalf of us? Will you trust me to be your spokesman? But then will you go home and pray over your family? I just walked through my grandkids. Not the kids don't count, but my grandkids are more important. Start with them. And I'm praying against the evil one. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. God, we come and we've really not officially bowed before you as a church and officially prayed as a church. And Lord, we've been foolish not to do this, oh God. We've not come together and come together and stood against this COVID-19 virus. But COVID-19 virus, in the name of Jesus, we command you to leave us alone. To get your sickness away from us. To get your disease away from us. To get all that you bring in the evil, take it plumb away. And we don't ask this in our name. We ask it in the name of Christ Jesus. And Satan, you need to know that Jesus said that if we resist you, that you will flee. And so mark it down in your calendar on this Sunday, in this place, that we are resisting you. We're not just going to sit down and give up. We're not just going to hunker in and hide out, Lord. We're going to get on our knees and come against you, Satan. So get your hellish things away from us, including this COVID-19. Get it away. Get it away. Now, God, I'm praying that you deliver us from evil. Deliver this church, Cape County Cowboy Church, and all the people associated with it, our families and their families. Oh, Holy Spirit, deliver us from this evil. Deliver us from this sickness. Deliver us, we pray. And for those that might have it among us, heal us, oh God. In the name of Jesus, heal us in the great physician's act of taking the bearing our sin and bearing our sickness on that cross. Not just our sin, but by his stripes we were healed. It's already been bought. Our health has already been paid for. Now, Holy Spirit, deliver to us what is already ours. In this world we shall have tribulation, but through Christ we can overcome the world. Lord, we can overcome the world, and we believe that to be true because you said it. And so today we pray on our behalf. Do what we can't do, but what you can do. What's impossible to us is more than possible with you, O God. At your invitation, Lord, we come and we stand against the sickness. We stand against the deliverer of this sickness. And we stand for you and we stand with you. Heal us and protect us, guard us and guide us. And we praise you for what you're going to do, Lord. We praise you for what you're going to do. We praise you, hallelujah, for what you've already bought, what you've already paid for, that you're going to deliver on our behalf and for the glory of your kingdom. Mark it down, heaven, that we have come expecting and come believing that you're enough for us. So be the God that you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We're dismissed.